Hello, everybody. So my name is Tagir Valeev, and I work at JetBrains. My main role is to enhance the Java language support in IntelliJ IDE. Today, I want to share with you some of my thoughts about Java Stream API. Stream API was released in Java 8 back in 2014, so it's already 6 years old, which is quite a long time in the software development world. It has got to the point that it's hard to imagine a world without Stream API. Why would I make a talk about Stream API? It's because I love it. I love it so much. I even devote my free time to contributing a number of Stream API enhancements and fixes to OpenJDK. So I have been deep into it and come out on the other side. I have seen things there on the inside and now know how it works and why it was designed this way. I've also created a separate library called StreamX that enhances the standard Stream API and provides considerably more features and syntactic sugar. I tried to strike a balance with the original Stream API philosophy and convenience, and I believe that the library I created definitely has its uses, and people will get value from it. It's just a hobby project of mine that I work on, and so nothing really to do with my work at JetBrains. If you are interested in checking it out, it's free of charge and open source. One of the things I love most about the Stream API is that it's composable. It's somewhat similar to water supply fixtures. You have a set of compatible pieces that you can connect together to make a single pipeline. Even the component names are quite similar. For example, you have filters, reducers, and even collectors. If you really want, you can even attach a downstream collector. Stream operations are connected in a similar way. For example, let's take a source that produces a stream of colored bars. Then we can take a transformation component named map, which in this case will squash our bars into blocks. Now we can add a filtration component, for example, a filter that removes all yellow blocks from the stream. Then finally, we can attach a sync or a terminal operation. For example, we can print the elements on the screen. We then just connect everything together and voila, it just works. Now let's assume we want to modify this pipeline somehow. For instance, let's install a meter. In the Stream API, we can implement a meter using the peak operation and an atomic variable. When we encounter an element, the meter increments the variable, so now we can check how many elements appear in the stream. If we want to install it between the map and the filter, we can simply disconnect these two operations, insert the meter there, and connect everything up again. It's a great feeling when you can take ready-made blocks and they connect perfectly together and work without problems. It's even more satisfying than Lego. I can see why people become plumbers. However, sometimes we go to take a ready-made component from our toolbox only to find out that it doesn't actually exist. Our vendor hasn't got the part we need in stock. Essentially, our Stream API Lego parts can be classified into three different kinds: sources, intermediate operations or transmissions, and terminal operations or things. So if you use Stream API quite often, sooner or later you'll see that you need more sources, more intermediate operations, and more things. The question is, can we make them ourselves? The answer is yes, but it's not always easy, and you might need to write your own library. Anyway, let's try. Let's start with the sources. These are the easiest things you can make by yourself. In some cases, creating a new source is really simple. We can take an existing source, then perform some intermediate operations and call the result a new source. For example, assume you have a DOM API and want to get all the child nodes for a given parent. That's the implementation. We query the node list, then create a stream of indices, starting from 0 up to the length not inclusive. Finally, we map the indices to the items using the item method. That's all. we can put this method into a utility class like XMLUtil or XMLStreams or whatever and use it from there. By the way, see the method name? It's not getChildren and not stream. It's simply children. There is a convention to name methods that return a stream using a plural noun, sometimes with an adjective. It's not a good idea to name such a method as stream unless you have a very abstract container that can contain just any kind of data, like a collection or an array. Here you can see some names of some standard JDK methods that return streams. There are many more methods like this, but you can get the idea from these samples. This approach allows you to stream any data container that provides its total number of elements and get quick random access by index. For example, if for whatever reason you happen to use Swing, you have a list model interface that provides its overall size and the element at a given index, which is great, as you have everything you need to stream elements of the list model. You can do it by yourself. There is another problem connected with this. You need to make a source consisting of list elements together with indices. This happens occasionally that you actually need indices. So you basically need a stream of pairs, like in this example. Well, there is no ready-to-use pair type in the JDK. Neither provides it a type that encapsulates a list element together with the index. So we have to create one. Let's call it indexed value. It contains two fields, index and value. I'm too lazy to write getters, equals, hashcode, and toString, so here's the minimal implementation with public final fields. By the way, if you use Java 14 with preview features turned on, you can replace this with a one-liner, and you get constructor, getters, equals, hashcode, and toString for free. Isn't that great? Now there is no need for a generic pair type, as you can create it in one line of code. Okay, let's go back to the streams. Now we are ready to create a stream with indices. We don't use list.stream as a starting point here, as it would make things much more complicated. Instead, we'll use range, like before. Then we can map to the indexed value using list.get. Yes, we are assuming that our list provides fast random access. If you still use linked list, today is a great day to stop. Please, please stop using it. And that's all. In general, if you have indexed access, you can solve many interesting problems. And the great thing about it is that streams created from instream.range can be nicely parallelized without any additional effort. Another common problem is to zip two lists together. Say you are given two lists with equal number of elements and you'd like to combine the first elements of both lists together, then the second elements of both lists together, and so on. Some developers say this is a sign of code smell because you should never find yourself in a situation where you have parallel lists like this. However, this happens in practice. First, let's think through how we want to use our yet-to-be-written stream source. To me, it should be something like this. A static library method called zip that accepts both the lists and the function with two arguments that defines how to combine the list elements. Such a signature is quite convenient. Some people really prefer the generic pair type. However, it's not too different. You can just specify a pair constructor as a function, then use a stream of pairs. So in our zip function, it doesn't really matter how you combine list elements. The method signature should look like this. We have three type parameters: the two types of list elements, and the result type. We accept list 1, list 2, and a mapper function. Don't forget about the pex signature. Now we should decide what to do when list sizes differ. Some zip implementations use the shorter list to determine the length of the output. I prefer to just throw an exception. It's better to fail fast. Now we get to the actual implementation, which is also not very complex. As usual, we start with a range of integer indices Then we apply the mapper to the corresponding list elements. And we are done. That's all there is to it. Our zip is working. Okay, range-based problems are quite boring. Let's do something a bit more interesting. We want to generate a Cartesian product over several lists. To simplify the problem, let's assume that we have lists of strings, and resulting elements must be concatenations of those strings. It can be useful, for example, to generate all kinds of alignments. Well, it's not exactly correct, as it says in the middle, neutral, neutral, instead of true, neutral, but suppose it's okay for us. So we want to get all 9 possible pairs from both lists. But what if another dimension appears? This alignment chart includes an additional simple complex dimension, raising the total number of alignments to 27. So we also want to generate all of them from the list of lists, but now we have 3 nested lists. If we know the number of nested lists in advance, we can utilize FlatMap. So we start streaming from the first nested list, then FlatMap its content using the second nested list, then FlatMap using the third nested list, and inside that FlatMap we have access to all 3 components. So we can map them to the concatenation A plus B plus C. The resulting stream actually contains all the 27 required elements. But this solution is not generic enough. We want to create alignment charts regardless of how many dimensions they have. Now I will show you a very elegant solution, though it might look really tricky. If you don't get it right now, try it by yourself after my talk. First, let's go back to 2 dimensions. Note that we cannot do something like this to combine 2 streams. That's because every stream can be operated only once. The output would be like this. When we visit FlatMap for the second time, we will see an exception because we want to traverse S2 again. We cannot do this. However, we can create a stream supplier. It's just a function that can create as many identical streams as we like. This way, we can call FlatMap without any problems. S2.get just returns a fresh stream every time we need it. Now for a bit of magic. We'll pack this transformation inside another stream supplier. So we get a new stream supplier that is a reduction over 2 original suppliers. So we have a reduction operation on stream suppliers. And this is completely valid reduction operation. It satisfies all the requirements. So basically, if we can reduce 2 stream suppliers, we can reduce a stream of stream suppliers. It could be done this way. Now our function to reduce stream suppliers gets its place inside the reduce operation. It returns an optional, so we should provide a default value inside or else, just in case our original input is empty. It may sound counterintuitive, but in this case, we must not produce an empty stream, but the stream of single empty string. The reason for this is the same as the reason why any number raised to the power of 0 equals 1. Now for the last bit. How do we make that stream of stream suppliers? This part is easy. We just stream the original outer list and map it to the list double colon stream method reference. See that we have a method reference inside the lambda. Note that we didn't process any input elements at all. We operated on functions only and produced a function as well. It looks like truly functional programming when you operate on functions rather than on particular values and get new functions as a result. This code could be generalized even more. Our solution assumes that we have a list of strings and want to concatenate them. It's possible, though, that we have list of lists of something else and want to combine them in some other way. And as an exercise, you can think up a generalized solution. There are more ways to create sources. For example, you can create one with an iterator, but it won't parallelize nicely. In any case, creating new sources is quite simple. Even without third-party libraries, you can create many sources in your code and use them conveniently. Unfortunately, it's not so easy with intermediate operations. Let's take a look at some situations where you would want to have a new intermediate operation. Let's start with a simple problem that can be implemented, albeit not ideally, using existing operations. From my experience, it's needed quite often. Given a stream of A, select all the elements that belong to a given subclass B. For example, let's go back to our code that returns all the XML nodes. Often, we don't need all the nodes. We want only elements. It looks like a simple filter with instance of will do the trick. Some people like method references, so the same semantics could be expressed using the method reference. However, in both cases, the resulting expression type is still stream of nodes, not stream of elements. How do we fix this? We can add a map step. Here you can also use either a lambda or method reference. It looks like this solved the problem. However, this solution is a bit ugly. We perform two connected steps, and we have to mention the same class twice. So it's called duplication, and it's error-prone. For example, there is a possibility that you mistakenly add a new operation between these two, or change the class in map, but forget to change it in the filter. Normally, we would encapsulate the duplication inside the method and call it that way. But this is a little bit problematic with streams. For example, we can create a method like this in a utility class. Call it select. However, when we start to use this method, we immediately understand that it makes us unhappy. Now we cannot fluently read the stream left to right. Instead, we should start from the middle, then at some point jump to the beginning, and finally go back to the end. And here we use only one such artificial intermediate operation. Imagine if we need several of them in a single stream pipeline. In this case, our beautiful pipeline will turn into this. There is an alternative solution for this specific kind of problem. Use the flat map operation. In fact, any chain of map, filter, peak, and flat map operations can be replaced with a single flat map call. Let's try this on a random pipeline. Here we have flat map to int, filter, peak, and map to obj. We can just move all the intermediate operations inside the flat map call. You see, now filter, peak, and map to obj are inside the flat map lambda. Afterwards, we can extract the lambda to a separate method and use it. Now we encapsulated the complex operation. Similarly, we can do something like this for select. We can even optimize it a little, because flat map allows us to return null instead of empty stream, so we can avoid creating a stream object if the instance of check fails. Now we can use this select method inside the flat map. In principle, this is better. We eliminated the duplication of element.class, collapsed two connected operations into one, and we don't need to sacrifice the fluent style. The stream still reads left to right. However, this change is not free. We create a separate stream object for each matching element. I believe GraalJIT can optimize it away, but C2, which is currently the default JIT compiler in Hotspot JVM, cannot. So this code may produce a lot of unnecessary garbage. Also, the usage pattern is somewhat counterintuitive. You don't actually want to flat map anything. You want to filter, or you want to select, but don't flat map. So here's another solution. Write your own library that extends Stream API, or use an existing library. As stream, instream, longstream, and doublestream are interfaces, it's quite possible to implement them, delegating the standard methods to the JDK stream and provide all the necessary stream sources that return your wrappers. After that, you are free to provide any additional methods you like. That's how my StreamX library was born, and probably this select operation was the first non-standard thing that I implemented. Let's consider a more interesting situation. Stream API already has a distinct method that leaves only unique elements. Suppose we need something even stronger. Let's say we want to have distinct elements, but only those that repeat at least 3 times in the original stream. If the element appears fewer than 3 times, we don't return it at all. The order of returned elements doesn't matter. For example, here we expect to have Scala, Groovy, and Kotlin in the result, but no Java, no Ceylon, and no Clojure, because they appear only once or twice. A possible solution is to do this in 3 steps. First, collect the original list using a grouping by collector that counts the number of occurrences. Then we remove the languages that have a number of occurrences less than 3, using the removeif method. Finally, use the keyset of this map, for example, create a new stream from it, or just print them using foreach. This works, but it would be nice to perform everything in a single stream. After all, if an element already appears at least 3 times, we would like to immediately pass it to the downstream operation without waiting until the whole input stream is processed. In particular, this would allow us to short-circuit an infinite stream. How can we do this? Without using third-party libraries, we can apply this hack. Let's create a utility method that accepts the minimal number of repetitions and returns a predicate. However, this predicate is stateful. It keeps the map, like the one we created on the previous slide. So every time we pass an element through the predicate, it increases the internal counter. When the counter reaches exactly the required number of occurrences, it returns true, allowing the elements to pass through. No matter how more occurrences it encounters after this, it will not return true again. See how easy it is to express this semantics with the map.merge operation. The nice part is that this operation is atomic for concurrent hash map. Thanks to this, the predicate works fine for parallel streams as well. So this is a working solution. Unfortunately, it violates the specification. It's explicitly specified in stream filter method documentation that the predicate must be stateless. So this solution works, but it's not guaranteed that it will work always. This particular case looks more or less harmless, but who knows what the future holds. Here's another case, kind of problem that requires a new intermediate operation. Process pairs of adjacent stream elements, as shown in the example. These are overlapping pairs. I want to supply a B function that maps 2 elements into 1 and get the output like this. The resulting stream naturally becomes 1 element shorter. So in this example, we had 4 elements as the input and only 3 elements as the output. To solve this problem, we can devise a stateful function, like what we did previously. This function is intended to be used with flat map in a similar way to the select problem we solved before. The implementation is not very complex. If we have a previous element, we feed it into the B function together with the current element and return a stream of the mapper result. If we don't have a previous element, then we are at the beginning of the stream. So we just return an empty stream. We can use it like this and get the desired result. However, such a solution is an even worse violation of the Stream API specification. In particular, it relies on the elements being processed sequentially from left to right. A proper way, if you use a parallel stream, you will get a very strange result like this. Or maybe something else. Nothing is guaranteed. And in this case, you cannot preserve the order simply by adding any synchronization barriers or using some concurrent collections or whatever. This won't work. A proper way to solve this problem is to write a custom splitterator. Doing this correctly is quite hard, and making it perform well for parallel streams is even harder. A splitterator class is declared in the Java util package, and its specification is quite big. This is only a small part of it. The specification also includes an example. So if you are really going to write your own splitterator, it's a good idea to read the specification. Basically, a splitterator is an enhanced iterator that can split into several parts for parallel processing. A stream is created from a splitterator, and you can get a splitterator from a stream. Remember that you will rarely need to deal with splitterators in your daily programming tasks. They are mostly useful when you want to write a library. There is quite a standard ceremony to do this. Stream API provides a stream support class for low-level operations like creating a new stream from the splitterator. You should supply your own splitterator and indicate whether the stream should be parallel. It's a good idea to inherit the parallelism flag from the original stream. Also, it's likely that your splitterator will have to use the input stream splitterator. So it's passed there. One more thing you must do is delegate close handlers. If the original stream holds a resource, like a file on file system, closing the resulting stream should close the original stream as well. Next, we need to implement the splitterator itself. The simplest way of doing this is to extend the abstract splitterator class provided by JDK. Abstract splitterator provides very limited parallelism capabilities. But the good thing is that it does it automatically, so you don't have to worry about parallel streams. And with this splitterator, you may even get improved parallel performance in certain situations. When you extend the abstract splitterator, you must provide a size estimation and characteristics. We can estimate the size based on the original splitterator size estimation. As we saw above, the resulting stream is exactly one element less than the original stream. But we should be careful to avoid returning a negative number. Also, if the original splitterator reports a max value size, it has a special meaning, like the size is infinite or too expensive to compute. So we should preserve it. Now the characteristics. We should be extremely careful with them, otherwise very subtle bugs may appear. For example, there are non-null, distinct, and sorted characteristics that the original splitterator may have, but we should not inherit them, because after the mapper function is applied, any of them could be lost. We can only be sure about sized and ordered. The first means that the original splitterator knows the stream size exactly. In this case, we know the size of the resulting stream as well. The second means that the order of stream elements matters, so we should preserve it. Now we should implement the try-advance method. It's like iterator has next and iterator next merged together. If we have one more element, we should pass it to the consumer and return true. Otherwise, we should return false without calling the consumer. The implementation can look like this. The idea is the same as before. Check the hasPrevious flag, update the previous value, and supply the previous and current one to the mapper. At this point, our splitterator is correct, but it's not as fast as it could be. If you are creating your own splitterator, especially if you delegate it to another one, I strongly recommend that you implement the for each remaining method as well. This method consumes all the remaining elements of the stream in cases where short circuit behavior is unnecessary. This method has a default implementation that delegates to try-advance. However, even if your try-advance is very optimal, the try-advance implementation of the original splitterator could be much less optimal. So, if your for each remaining can delegate to the original splitterator for each remaining, your non-short circuiting operations may become considerably faster. Now we get good performance for sequential streams. Here we will stop with splitterators. It's a very interesting challenge to try and get the maximum performance out of this pair map splitterator in parallel streams. However, it would take too long to talk about this today. It's implemented in my StreamX library, so if you are curious about it, you can always take a look at the source code. Now let's move to the terminal operations, or syncs. When we have a stream, it should eventually be consumed by somebody. Creating custom consumers is simpler than creating intermediate operations, but harder than creating custom sources. Here, the Stream API designers provided us with the capability to encapsulate new terminal operations via a custom collector. The collector interface allows us to provide a custom terminal operation by specifying four functions and three characteristics. It's often possible to combine the collector from existing collectors instead of writing your own from scratch. To demonstrate how collectors can be combined, let's solve the following problem. Let's say you have a list of maps and want to transform it into a single map that uses all the keys from all the input maps and combines all these corresponding values into lists. Here is an example input and the expected output. Essentially, we just need to rearrange the data. A canonical solution looks like this. As we have a nested data structure, it's natural that we start with a flat map and flatten all the nested maps into a single stream of entries. Afterwards, we can use a collector that we create from the existing collectors. It looks somehow tricky and probably hard to read if you don't do such things often. Grouping by means that we want to group elements into a map using entry keys as qualifiers. Mapping is like a normal stream map operation. We extract values, then put them into the list via collectors.toList. Finally, we just need to add four closing parentheses, and it works. Problems where you need to rearrange maps or lists are quite popular, so I created a lot of sugar in StreamX to simplify them. In fact, there is a special type in the StreamX library called EntryStream, which is a stream of map entries. It has a number of operations that automatically extract keys and values from entries, making the pipelines much shorter and easier to read. If you cannot use third-party libraries for whatever reason, you can still simplify your code using static import of the collectors class. This doesn't save you from having many nested parentheses, but it does certainly make the collector more readable. Sometimes developers want to solve every single possible problem in a single stream pipeline, even if that's not the appropriate way to do it. For example, let's consider the following problem. We have a list of all the employees, and every employee had an annual salary and a department. We want to get all the departments where the total salary exceeds 1 million and sort the results by salary. It's perfectly normal to solve this problem in two steps. First, we group employees by departments, telling the grouping by collector to sum the salaries using the summing long downstream collector. Now, we stream the result in map again, filtering by salary, sorting the result, and collecting it into a new map. Here we need a linked hash map to preserve the sorting order. We cannot use tree map because we are sorting map values, not map keys. But there is a little problem. If we want to explicitly specify the map type, we have to explicitly specify the merge function. The merge function tells the collector what to do if duplicate keys appear in the stream. There is no standard to map collector where you can specify the map type but omit the merge function. In this case, we would be happy with a default merge function that throws an exception on duplicate keys because we are sure that our keys are not duplicated. Usually people write something like A, B, arrow A, like on this slide, just because it's much shorter than A, B, arrow, throw new illegal state exception, blah, blah, which will never happen anyway. However, it's a little bit dirty and can make the code hard to read. If you specify A, B, arrow A, readers might assume that repeating keys are actually possible in your case, because why you are specifying this merger. So it's up to you to decide. Of course, if you can use StreamX, you won't have this problem. There is a special method called toCustomMap that allows you to specify a target map with or without a merge function. Of course, it's just a bit of sugar. There is nothing really that special there. In fact, even without third-party libraries, the solution looks perfectly okay. Some people, however, really want to pack it into a single stream pipeline, resulting in ugly code like this. I didn't make this up. I really saw this kind of code. And it looks like the developers who wrote it really think that it's better this way. Here, a combining collector, collecting and then is used. It allows you to add any final transformation to the result, and the final transformation is just the complete second stream. Well, it may look like a functional approach. We are doing a functional composition. Also, we don't create an intermediate local variable. However, code like this is much more difficult to understand and debug. I have given this kind of behavior a very scientific name of streamosis. Please don't do this. Don't be obsessed with the idea that every problem can be solved in a single stream pipeline. Write readable code, please. Sometimes you can't combine existing collectors and you need to write a collector manually. When it's possible, it's usually not that hard. Here is a problem that cannot be solved by combining standard collectors. We want to find the maximal elements of the stream. However, if there is a tie, we want to get all the maximal elements. Here is an example. Out of these languages, let's find the ones with the longest names. As you can see, the longest names is 6 characters, and Kotlin, Groovy, and Ceylon all satisfied. So we should return all 3 of them. Here is simple implementation. To create a collector, we should decide which container to use and learn how to accumulate new elements, merge 2 containers together, and transform the container into the final result. Here, we can use ArrayList as a container, and it's also our final result, so the finisher step is unnecessary. The container contains the largest elements found so far. The accumulator accepts the new element T, and if it's not the first element, then it checks whether it's larger than the largest element we already have or not. If it's smaller, we just ignore it. If it's larger, then we clear the list to forget the previous elements because we have a new leader. Otherwise, we just add a new element to the collection of the largest ones. A combiner is used for parallel streams, and it should combine 2 results that were calculated in parallel lists for 2 parts of the input. In our case, it's possible to do quite a simple implementation. We just feed all the elements from the second list to the accumulator, updating the first list. Then we return the first list as a resulting container. It's perfectly okay to modify and return one of the previous accumulators instead of creating a new one. We could make it a little bit more optimal, but this solution is good enough for most practical cases. Now you can simply implement the collector interface, but it's better to use the convenient static method collector.off that provides the implementation for you. The problem is solved. To me, there are 2 main issues with collectors. One is that you must specify a combiner, even if you don't care about parallel streams. Spliterator, for example, has a legal way to refuse splitting. In this case, the stream created from the spliterator will be sequential, even if the parallel method was called. You can't do the same thing with collectors. On the other hand, there are cases when it's impossible to write a correct combiner because it must be associative, and not every operation is associative. Some people just throw unsupported operation exception from the combiner if they don't need parallel streams. It's probably not that bad in some local usages, but I think it's unacceptable in libraries. As a result, some operations cannot be expressed via collectors at all. The second issue I have found with them is that a collector cannot legally short-circuit. Stream API will handle all the stream elements even if at some point the collector already knows that the final result is found and will not change anymore. So if you want to create your own short-circuiting terminal operation, you cannot use collectors. Here's an example of a problem that needs a short-circuiting behavior. We want to check all the stream elements are unique. As soon as we find a repetition, we can return false immediately without consuming the rest. We could write a collector, but it won't allow us to short-circuit. To solve a problem like this, we can check existing short-circuiting terminal operations and check whether any of them could be adapted for our purpose. Here is a possible solution involving all match. It's short and elegant, and will work with parallel and sequential streams alike. But it's also an API abuse, because we use a stateful function. Here we create a concurrent set. Since Java 8, there is a method in the concurrent hash map to create one. Then we bind it to the method reference that adds a new element to the set. Set.add returns true if the element was successfully added, and false if the corresponding element already existed in the set. That's exactly what we need. Once we get a repeating element, we will return false, relying on the short-circuiting mechanism inside the allMatch method. Unfortunately, not every custom short-circuiting operation can be implemented so easily, especially if you want fast parallel processing. In the StreamX library, I added a mechanism of short-circuiting collectors, which allows you to solve such problems. Finally, let's consider a problem that cannot be parallelized normally. Let's assume that we want to calculate the string hash code using Stream API. Why not? The exact formula is specified. In fact, you just need to multiply the current result by 31, then add the next character code, and so on. After a bit of thinking and combining the operations, we find that the following code works. Yes, we can create a stream of string characters. It will be an int stream. Then we can apply the reduction operation. As you can see, it works correctly. Great. Unfortunately, this doesn't work if we add parallel. It produces a completely different result. Stream API was designed so that a properly written stream should produce identical results, regardless of whether it's parallel or sequential. It can be faster or slower, but the result must be the same. But why doesn't it work? If we check the documentation for the reduce method, we will see that the accumulator must be an associative function. It's actually written three times in meta documentation. So it looks like this is a pretty important thing. And we can easily check that associativity doesn't hold in our case. Okay, now we know why it doesn't work. But is it possible to fix this? Of course, we can ignore the problem. Who needs to calculate the hash code in parallel? However, the specification doesn't guarantee in which order reduce will be called for the sequential version as well. It's unlikely, but the sequential version might be broken in future versions of Java. In any case, it would be nice to fix it. Such an operation in other languages is called fold left or reduce left, and it's specified to be applied from left to right, so no associativity is required. It cannot be implemented using collect or reduce, but it's quite possible to implement it using for each ordered operation, which guarantees left to right processing. Look how it can be implemented for int stream. For an object stream, you can easily write it yourself. You may wonder what the point of using this operation in parallel is. However, in some cases, you can get a speed boost if you have very complex upstream operations in the pipeline. Another way to solve this problem, as well as many other problems, is to give up. Sometimes it's better to admit that not every problem has an elegant solution with Stream API, and plain old for loops may be easier to understand. So that's all for today. We discussed a number of ways to modify existing stream operations or create your own. Please use standard API when it makes your code more readable, and avoid Stream API in cases where it's not suitable. Thank you. Here are some ways that you can use to get in contact with me, and I will be happy to answer your questions.
Thank you so much for a fantastic presentation. I'm sorry I trampled all over it at the last minute. I was trying to get ready for the next presentation. And we have a lot of great questions. I'm not sure we're going to get time to ask and answer all of them, but let's take 5-10 minutes to ask some of the questions, if that's all right. One of the main comments that we got was people love your slides. They think the animation is fantastic. They love the quality of the slides. They found it really helpful to understand how streams work. So, and I love them too. It really helped me understand things that I thought I understood before, but apparently not.
Thank you.
And a great question here. Are there any plans or rumors about adding some new stream operations in the standard libraries? Or maybe you have an idea what you would personally like to see in streams next?
That's very good and interesting question. Well, now standard Stream API is more or less crystallized and there is no active development there. But sometimes some small additions are performed. If you check what's new in like Java 9, Java 12, you can see that there are some new collectors like filtering, flat mapping, TIN, and there are some new sources, but no intermediate operations, probably except take while and drop while that appeared in Java 9. One of the reasons is that, as I said in my presentation, Stream is an interface, and there are already third-party implementations of this interface. So if you add new intermediate or terminal operation, you must provide a default implementation, probably not optimal default implementation, but it must be correct, because otherwise you will break all third-party code. So this actually limits on what you can add in newest versions. Still, I know that there is a proposal being discussed now to add map multi operation that an alternative to flat map in a push-like case when you can actually push elements to the stream rather than provide them in pooling mode. It's currently discussed in mailing list, so probably it will arrive around Java 16. So some development is still going on there.
Great. And we had a lot of questions, not unusually, about the performance of stream operations in general. So questions like, is the stream method in a list, for example, is it very expensive in terms of performance? And a similar question, is it more expensive to use streams versus using plain old Java?
In most of real use cases, it doesn't really matter because usually the performance bottleneck of your program is somewhere else. So if Stream API makes your code more readable, easier to understand, please use it. If you see your Stream operations appear in performance profile, then okay, probably in your particular case, this is really hotspot and should be rewritten by using a plain old loop. By the way, IntelliJ IDEA in many cases can do this for you. You can just press Alt-Enter on your stream call and say just convert it to the loop. There are some cases when Stream may produce a lot of garbage. For example, if you use a flat map and produce many, many of very small streams, then every single small stream will add a garbage and garbage collector will have to deal with this. Again, Graal project deals with this really nice. They have, in most of the cases, if you use Stream API and Graal JIT, you will have exactly the same performance like with a loop. So probably in future, Graal JIT will become the default JIT, and this question will be irrelevant you will have the same performance.
That's really cool. I didn't know that about GAR. That's really interesting. My answer around performance is always like test it and then find out if you've got a performance problem. You can't predict it upfront. Another couple of questions around peak. Again, sort of related. Can peak be used for anything other than logging? And can you use peak for producing a side effect like atomic variable changes? Is that an anti-pattern?
In general, yes, you should avoid peak in production code. But if you understand how it works and what are consequences, I don't think you should avoid it as much as possible. For example, there is a pattern, then you have previous operation, then you create a brand new object. Like you have previous map, you create a brand new object there, and then you want to call a setter on that object to set some field, because probably you don't have a constructor to set this field right in the constructor. So to me, it's perfectly okay to add a peak operation and set this field in the peak, because even if at some point stream processor will exclude this peak operation, then it will exclude the previous map as well. Then it means that you don't need this object at all, so you won't get any side effect visible. In this case, your peak will have a side effect, but the side effect is encapsulated within the stream, so it will work perfectly. But probably if you need peak, you should think twice whether you need stream. Probably your code would look better with plain old for loop.
Oh, this is a good one. What's the most idiomatic way of generating infinite streams? It feels so easy with Reactor Publisher, for example, but pure Java streams feels more tricky.
It depends on your source. And there are a number of infinite stream sources in JDK. For example, you can get a stream of random numbers using like random.ints or random.longs if you need it. And alternatively, you can use stream.generate standard method provide a supplier that just generates new objects, or use stream.iterate if your next stream element could be calculated out of the previous element. In my practice, true infinite streams are rarely useful. So it depends on your problem. If you really have a problem that produces an infinite stream, then probably you can use one of existing sources. Or alternatively, you can create an infinite iterator. Infinite iterator is pretty easy. Just return true from your hasNext always and provide something from your next. And there is a standard method to wrap iterator into stream and return it. So you can create it.
So the answer is it depends. There are lots of different ways of doing it. Two people ask the same question. How do you assert that two streams are equal?
The question is, how can I say whether two streams are equal? Yes?
Yeah.
So it means that both streams have the same elements in the same order. I don't think there is a good standard solution. It could be a good problem for my presentation, one of the problems I demonstrated today. And I can disappoint you that this even is not solved in StreamX library. Because you should provide a terminal operation for one of the streams, but you cannot normally consume both streams in the same terminal operation. There are some ways to do this. For example, you can get iterator from both streams and or splitterator and get elements one by one and compare them to each other. But in most cases, you can just collect both streams to lists and compare the lists. If it doesn't pose a performance problem for you, then it's perfectly fine solution.
This is less of a question and more of a comment. It says it's meaningless to use parallel streams in web applications. I don't know if you have any comments on that.
In general, you must be very careful with parallel streams, and you should understand what are you doing. You should understand what the problem you are solving, and in some cases, parallel streams may make your performance of your application even worse. For example, yes, if you have a web application, and say you have 64 cores on backend, and you have more than 64 concurrent requests, then of course all your cores are already busy and you don't have any room to parallel your problem. But if you expect not very big load, for example, you expect no more than 10 concurrent connections to your web service, then you have free cores and parallel streams may reduce latency and make your server faster to respond. So again, it depends.
There's a question of whether you accept pull requests to StreamX. It says they've got an idea of how to improve standard Boolean supplier. So I guess the question is, do you accept pull requests?
Yes, I do accept the pull request, and I have a number of external contributors, and some of them really provided non-trivial contributions, like written a completely new operation written from the scratch, not like documentation fix. And but I ask you, please discuss your idea first before running into the implementation. I have some kind of philosophy in my library. Probably it's not readily written in some document, and I have some quite strict rules on how the code should look like, what should be the performance. I'm very strict about the performance inside the library. So if you have some idea, please discuss with me. Probably I can give you some hints how to implement it, or I will say, like, I tried already and this cannot be implemented in the way that satisfies me, so sorry, and you will not waste your time for implementation. But yes, pull requests are very welcome.
And we don't really have much time for any more questions, but there are a bunch of questions here and I don't think we're going to get a chance to finish it all off. Maybe I'll ask you one more. There's a couple of questions around handling exceptions in streams. So one question is, can we use exception handling in streams? And the other is, handling of exceptions in streams API is not supported. Can it be tackled in any way using streams?
It's quite a long discussion about exceptions in stream. At first, there are checked exceptions, and yes, if your Lambda throws a checked exception, it's not supported by the stream. So the normal way is okay to wrap and re-throw it as unchecked exception. And after that, the problem is that what do you want? What do you expect from handling exceptions in the stream? For example, if some intermediate step throws an exception, what would you like to do? Do you like to stop the stream processing and catch it, or would you like to collect all the exceptions and process successful elements and failed elements separately? Those are different cases. There are some solutions in the wild. My StreamX library doesn't address this problem in any way, but there are solutions in the wild, like try Monad you may find that wraps either successful or failed result inside. So if you really like functional approach, you like it. Or there are some ways to rethrow as unchecked. They are dirty, but some people still happy with them. But okay, I think this is a topic for another big talk.
Thank you so much, Tagir. It was a very useful presentation. I loved it. We will say goodbye now. Thank you.
Thank you for listening, and I was very glad that you invited me. Goodbye.